And such is the movie Left Behind. I don't know if you've seen that series. It was kind of ironic when I was a student at Moody. The two men that wrote the book, so Jerry Jenkins and Tim LaHaye, Jerry was teaching our creative writing class at the time, and he would come to class with manuscripts of Left Behind, and he would ask us what we thought of this, and he was trying to teach us to write concretely so that you would compose messages for the eye and not just the ear. And these learnings, though, this concept of the rapture, this movie, is it just fantastical kind of thoughts? We often think about it in this culture today. We think about this idea of the end of the world, the apocalypse. We think about these moments when things will go sideways. And is there any such thing as this thing called the rapture? Maybe you grew up in the church and you were introduced to the rapture, and maybe that was a concept that scared the hell out of you, literally. Maybe, I remember when I was a kid, there was a theory going around. It was called the partial rapture of the church. And the partial rapture of the church is a theory that some, the really, really, really guys and gals that were tight with God went home to be with him. First, like a pre-rapture, and then the rest of us untermenschens would kind of go after that. And again, there's been so many things said about the rapture of the church over the years. And so as we think about this thing of rapture, I want us to think about that. April 3, 1843. On that day, all over the Northeast, 500,000 Seventh-day Adventists were waiting for the return of Christ. And their teacher, William Miller, told them that this day would come. And so people, they quit their jobs. They went up on housetops to be the first to go. They had wanted that head start. Others were in the graveyards planning to be rejoined with their loved ones that had gone before. In fact, some of the higher brow societies of ladies of the upper society crust wanted to go outside of town because they didn't want to go with the common herd. Again, this crazy thinking that goes on. You've maybe received literature in the mail. I was going back in my files. I've found since I've been on the planet, a rapture was supposed to happen in 88, in 89, in 94, in 95, in 98. And then Harold Camping had his 1989 rapture that he was marketing towards, and everybody was supposed to just believe them, because they had figured out the biblical cues and they had uncoded it and unlocked the secrets so that they knew exactly when he was coming back. The good thing is, all those guys were wrong, and gals. They postulated this idea, and the sponsors, they missed their dates too, so we're good, all right? So we're here today, and we want to talk about the rapture of the church, because I'm convinced that when we understand this, if we understand this teaching, and it's a teaching of the Bible, it's not Narnia, it's not fanciful, it's true, it's truth. If we get this, and it really seeps into us, it has the potential to change how we live our lives. And so that's the principle today that God's promises about tomorrow give us hope in how we live today. And again, I love that about prophecy. Prophecy is tomorrow today. It's pre-written history. And so one of the classic passages that we have in the Bible that teaches us about the rapture of the church is the passage before us today. So if you have a Bible, please turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. We want to unpack, and I want to really kind of orbit around these questions today. And so as we go through, these are the questions that I think the big broad brush stuff, if you are not a church person, if you're new to the church, welcome to Bridgeway. And I want to make sense of these learnings so that you can just benefit from them. Before we do that, again, mad respect to the worship team and Aaron and company. I think you see the cluster of speakers that is above us. That's 296 pounds a speaker, and it's very secure. So if you're underneath it, not to worry. There are two cables in the back end, so if it does happen to go in a catastrophic, maybe a rapture event, the pendulum thing will come right down and take out the pulpit. So that'll end the sermon, and it'll be fast and furious, and on we will go. But we appreciate it. Isn't it? It's great to have the sound system. so sick of the old system that was on its last legs. It was like a Lazarus system that had to have mouth to mouth. And now we've got a good system. And thank you, Pastor Aaron and company, for making that happen. All right, first question is, does the Bible teach that a rapture will occur? Well, look at the scriptures. Look with me as we look at this passage, and I want to just unpack it in a way that's practical and hopefully answer some of the macro questions related to this thing of rapture. Look what it says. Paul says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command and with the voice of an archangel and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord." And so if you're a person that says, "I'm a biblicist, I believe the Bible," if you say you believe the Bible, that means that you look to the Bible for answers, right? Isn't that nice? We talked about this a few weeks ago. The church, this is the scary thing, the church. The average churchman and woman, according to Lifeway Research, the average Christian does not pick up their Bible but once a month. 80% just pick it up once a month, maybe. Only 20% pick up the Bible in any kind of way daily. That is a devotional incoming to your inbox or a text. Do you see a problem with that? I mean, if I'm not biblically engaged, this concept of rapture may seem fantastical and may seem like something, that's what old school people believed. Remember the old days in this church? We had some of those old days. We would have prophecy conferences for a week or two at a time. And the reason we had those was because the Bible teaches about this thing called rapture. What is the rapture of the church? Well, literally, it comes from the Latin, which is rapio, which means to snatch. It means to grab violently. That's kind of an interesting image. So it's a time when God chooses to come back for his church. We believe in the first coming of Christ, and we call that Christmas. That's the incarnational moment when the Son of God, eternity, stepped into time, became one of us, and we beheld his glory. Well, that rapture word, rapio, was translated rapazo in the Greek. And again, it has this word that means this idea of taking out. There's some images in the Bible that talk about this rapture. If you go to the story in your mind of Philip, remember Philip? He was preaching to the Ethiopian eunuch, and the Bible says that he was snatched away. That is the Philip, that is after he shared the gospel from the book of Isaiah, the prophet. He was snatched away, taken away, as it were. You think of Elijah, who was taken away in a fiery chariot. He was taken out of this world. The concept of a God who steps into the space-time world and removes from this planet his people is a clear teaching of the Bible. And so it's that idea of firmly taking something forcefully, quickly, to seize, to carry off. Let's talk about this with more clarity. It is something that's very distinct. So there's so much confusion. I think the confusion comes even more so because we're not as biblically engaged as we should be. The older generations were more literate biblically than the modern generation. And so we're trying to rage against that at Bridgeway. It's one of the reasons we met this morning. We had a gang of, I think, 10 of our people in this group. We're looking to get more biblically engaged to become what God wants us to be, Christomorphic disciples. But this is a distinct event. And I want to talk about it because when you read the Bible, you need to ask a question. And if you have your bulletin, please grab that at this moment. I want you to see, there's a handout in there, and this is made for young eyes. If you have young eyes, you'll be able to see all the font. If it's older, I apologize. Take out your bifocals. But this is a summary. This is my summary of the book of Revelation in graphic form. And I just want to focus. You can get lost in all the details. I want to have you focus on the midline in the middle of the page, the black line. If you go about halfway over, you'll see a green line going up, and that is called the rapture of the church, and it says phase one. And then if you go across to the right, you see the invasion or the revelation, and that's phase two. And do you see above all that? They're both connected with a simple concept. the second coming of Christ. So my point is, the Bible teaches a second coming of Christ, but it's a two-phased event. The first phase being the rapture of the church, when God the Father sends in his Son to grab his church. It's an imminent event. That means nothing has to happen before that. In fact, we could take the time and we could contrast the rapture of the church versus the revelation or the second coming of Christ. Let me just take a couple of minutes to clear up confusion, because when we study the Bible, sometimes what we're reading is about rapture. This is before what we call the tribulation. Other times we're looking at the revelation, which is after the tribulation. And it's a very different event. Let me help you contrast. And again, with this kind of pan here, let me just show you the differences. Christ comes in the air, according to the Bible, for his saints. That's the rapture of the church. The second coming of Christ, Christ comes with his church, the bride. So we've been with him and being evaluated, the bema seat of Christ. One is for, one is with. The preposition matters. The Old Testament, the rapture, is not a subject of the Old Testament writings at all. But the second coming of Christ is. It's all through the major and minor prophets. It's a very different thing. In the church, we're talking about the Israel's 70th week, and that is something, again, the rapture occurs before this as compared to after it. We could take a lot of time and get a lot of clarity, but I think the key thing is the rapture is something that starts the judgment seat of Christ, the evaluation of people who have accepted Christ, but their works are evaluated, not to see if they get in, but to see if there's rewardability for things done in Jesus' name. But the revelation, all that's already done, and we come back with Christ as his warriors. It terminates, the rapture terminates the fullness of the Gentiles. And again, the idea of the revelation does not, it's the result of that moment. And so the imminency, that it can happen at any moment, the rapture of the church. And I hear that pop going on. I think my electric personality is creating pops or something, or static electricity, or the rapture, or that thing's getting ready to fall. Maybe that's it. Okay. Meeting of the bridegroom with the bride versus the coming with the deliverer. Again, do you get the point? That the rapture is different than the second coming of Christ. And when people go to like Matthew 24 and they see that people are working in the field and one is taken and the other is left behind, they're confused. They're confused. The one taken is taken in judgment. That's not the rapture. That's the revelation. The one who's left behind goes on into the millennial moment. It's a very different learning. And so it's distinct. But it's also, again, this thing of imminent, and there's some of the key distinctions, and you can look at those. Do you know this difference? And I think if you're a child of God, if you're a biblicist, if you say, I believe the Bible, that means you believe the teachings of the Bible. We must confess that there is confusion, I believe, and there's differentness of opinion. I confess that. So I stand before you today to say that when I went to Moody, when I graduated, I had it all figured out. Now, 25 years later, I can tell you I have not figured it all out. There's a lot more question marks in my mind. I know he's coming back, but the clarity relates to this issue, and it's an issue that we need to understand, that he is coming back. I believe that. It's imminent, and if I can get my device to work right. Wow. All right, it is demon-possessed there. Give me 1 second. Let me just catch it up. Here we go. So the concept, again, that it's imminent. The scriptures are clear that it's a snatching. He's coming back. That it's different than the revelation. It's the rapture. It's imminent versus a lot of signs have to come before the second coming of Christ. And the imminent things, it could happen at any moment. Do you believe that? The Bible says that nothing else has to happen at all before he can come back. Nothing. Nothing else has to happen. The stage is set. So if I believe that, should that change my behavior? Should that impact how I live? Are there certain things you'd want to be doing versus not doing if you really believe that Christ is coming back for his church? He's going to come snatch me out and take me away. See, I believe that it should. The Bible says that we are the children of God, and it does not appear what we will be, but we know that when he appears, we will be like him, because we'll see him as he is. And so everybody who has this hope, the blessed hope, the rapture in him, should purify himself even as he is pure. And so holiness is something that burns off the dross in our lives. It's an imminent thing that could happen at any moment. I think back to my days of working at UPS. Interesting job, built character. And it was an ultimate middle of the morning, night workout. Like, I don't know, 10 o'clock at night till like 3 in the morning. It was a good moment in my Bible college days. And one of the things that we always hated about that job was that the workers that were a part of the union, we had these like Judas-like characters. These were the auditors, and they were not a part of the union. They didn't care. Their job was to audit you. And so they would stand at the back of the truck sometimes, and they'd just sit there with a stopwatch, and they would watch you take out your packages. So I think we had 2 seconds each when we were unloading a truck to bring that telescopic conveyor belt into the truck and to dump them out. And we only had 3 seconds when we were loading a truck to build walls, to build those tractor trailers, fill them with packages. The thing that we hated about these auditors was that for every truck, you had so many zip codes, maybe 40 zip codes, let's say, that you had to read. When you would come in, and the package would come in, you had to visually look at the package, and you had to memorize whether or not and know if this was to come in or not. So these little snitches, these auditors, their job was to throw bad sorts, bad zips into your truck above the line, so it's coming into the conveyor belt, and they would watch and see if you would catch it. Because a bad parcel could come imminently at any moment, and you needed to be ready, and you needed to be able to catch that and take it out. At the end of the day, in the culture of fear, it was so interesting. They would post the results of the performance of the workers. And on the columns at the end of the shift, you'd see who are the perfect ones and who are the ones that didn't catch the bad sorts. And this is how they motivated. And then they'd tell you that there's another 1,000 people standing behind you for this job. And if you don't perform, you're gone. The imminency, the nature of this. The Bible teaches this doctrine that nothing else must happen before the rapture can occur. So how does that make you feel? I remember when I was anticipating marrying Susan, I was thinking, well, I sure hope he doesn't come before I get married to Susan. That would be horrible. So the idea of the rapture was a weird concept that it's going to rob me of joy. I'm somehow, like when I was a kid, I was working hard to earn money for a bike, and I sure hope he doesn't come back before I buy this bike, because is that the right attitude? No. We're humans, locked in a body, given to flawed thinking. And yet this conviction that the Lord's coming, this conviction that he's going to come back and we will all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, that he will morphically reconstruct us in a way that we can only try to figure out in our minds. It's a crazy, crazy idea. And so Paul confirms it, and the Bible teaches it, and that the Lord is, we're told, Maranatha, even so, come, Lord Jesus. And it will be rapid. And again, look at the scriptures there in Corinthians. Behold, I tell you a mystery. It is a mysterion that we shall not all sleep. Bible doesn't teach soul sleep. It does not teach that. When you die, what happens? Do you assume room temperature like a deer does when you harvest it? No. The Bible doesn't teach that. I know some cults teach that. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so when our heart stops beating, this afternoon we're going to a kind of a viewing party. One of our neighbors at the end of this cul-de-sac, she passed away suddenly on Wednesday and had a massive heart attack. The moment our heart stops, the moment we die, we are catapulted into eternity. And so it says, I tell you, this is for the Christian, we shall not all sleep. Again, the euphemism for death. We shall not all die, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. And so the Bible is talking about an event. The whole tone is, again, this expectation. Paul thought that Christ could come back before he got done his ministry on this planet. He was convinced of that. So if the Apostle Paul believed in the imminency of Christ's return, shouldn't we? And should we not adjust our affairs and how we live? And so I think it's a fair question. I think it's a very fair question to say, how am I then living in this world? Am I living as if the only thing that matters is the material world, the things that I hold on to? Is that all that matters? I love these gatherings. This is a gathering of these friends with this lady who passed away Wednesday. It'll be a gathering of a lot of pain. And we've been trying to inject the gospel into that neighborhood for the past 19 years we've lived there. And the gospel, no doubt, will hopefully come up again starting at 3, so we'd appreciate your prayers. Trying to understand that this gospel is a gospel of grace. It's for all. But God wants us to understand that for the Christian, though, man, this left-behind clip that we began with, is it going to be catastrophic? Absolutely. I think they do a decent job. I'm not a big fan of Christian movies, and I hope you know what I mean when I say that. Most of the time, they're like B, C grade embarrassing, but even though that thing is ancient, I still think it gets across the idea. Could that happen? Could it be that as a pilot is flying across the pond over to Europe, could it be that a co-pilot disappears, or the pilot like Sean Riggs, or Mark Fisher, who used to come here years ago? Could that happen? Yes, that one is left behind and the one stays. Is it going to happen where the clothes collapse and the fillings are left behind and the screws from OSS, you know, and the bodywork is all left behind in a pile and you're gone? Your toupee and all the fake eyebrows, all that stuff, is that all going to just collapse? And I think it's pretty fair. It says that we're all going to be changed. Does this present some problems, this idea of a rapture, that he's going to take the dead in Christ will rise first? But let's be clear, not everybody dies in a clean, easy way. Some people perish in a fire and they basically are incinerated. Some people are lost at sea and they become fish bait and their body is, you know, consumed by several marine type animals. Is God big enough and capable enough? Is the rapture a literal actual event that will happen? I believe you're left to say yes. Even though the word rapture is not in the Bible, just like the word Trinity is not, but the Bible clearly teaches that doctrine. And so the idea that crazy things will happen, planes will crash, and neighbors will be missing, and the panic of the moment, it launches the most epic moment that this world has ever seen, called Jacob's Trouble. It's a crazy time, and yet the Bible says that there's the place where we are heading. This rapid event will be one that will happen so fast and so quick. And so there's a degree of urgency. So if you're a parent, you got to share the gospel with your kids. The gospel that there's bad news, I'm a sinner. Life without Jesus results in spiritual death and separation from him for all eternity, that Jesus died for sinners like us. I have to embrace the gospel by faith and put my faith in him alone. That's the only way that I can become related to God. We need to share that with our kids. Grandparents, you have a crazy obligation. What a great privilege we have to have our little people around us until they go home. It's awesome, right? It's a great time. But you have an influence. You have capital. Are you using it for the kingdom? Are you talking to them about the God talk? Are you getting the God vocabulary? Are you talking about the gospel and getting that bad news, good news story into their little minds? Because that's the reality of what's coming. Paul says a rapture is coming. Literally, when it says a twinkling of an eye, it's an atom of an eye. It's the smallest unit of measurement. It's going to happen fast. Number two, let's talk about, again, who will be taken in the rapture. And it's a very exclusive thing. So here we have an artist rendition. Okay, interesting. But what does the Bible say? It says right there, it will not be all-inclusive. Not everybody is going to go be with Jesus. Rob Bell is wrong. He's wrong. Anybody who tells you that we're all the people of God and we're all going to go to heaven has not read the Bible. What does our passage say? That the dead in Christ will rise first. But it's the in Christ people. It may sound elitist to you. It may sound like heavenly snobbery. But that's the condition that God requires for people that are going to go in the rapture moment. And so the rapture, as it says and shows in that image, the dead will rise first, and we will be right on their tails. These flowers are in memory of Dan Sharp. And again, our hearts continue to go out to the family in the loss of their stepfather. And as we were out there at the Susquehanna Memorial Gardens this week, on whenever it was, Thursday, I think it was, as we were there having that moment, I often think about this is going to be like ground zero at the rapture moment, that the ground is going to quake and it's going to rumble and it's going to belch up the people who died in Christ, and they will go first and we'll be right behind. That is the ones who are alive at that moment, at the coming of our Lord. So it's exclusive. And again, the Bible does not make any bones about it. So I love the fact that the Bible says that all people can think about the gospel. They have a decision to make, up or down on Jesus. Are they clear that this is something that God has given to us? The world has a message. The church has been stewarded with the gospel, and we're supposed to share it with the people in the path of our lives. Why? Because the dead in Christ will rise first. If you're not related to God properly, maybe this is why you're here today, to think about the gospel. It's not joining a church. It's not being dunked in a pool of water or a tank. It's not having Holy Communion. It's not even celebrating the holy day of the Resurrection Sunday, going to a breakfast or a sunrise service. All those things are great. Coming to church is good. But it doesn't take away the sin of and the stain on our hearts that we all have inherited from Adam. And so I want to make sure that we're clear. There's a condition. In the end, love does not win. In the end, love does not empty out hell. In the end, universalism, this idea that all people are saved, just go tell them, is not the message and the teaching of the Bible. We must individuate. We must personalize. We must interiorize the gospel for us, ourselves. Have you done that? It's a simple question, and yet it's one that's very troubling. You say, but Dave, what about, let's talk about some of the questions related to this, because I know people get all wigged out at times and they think about this moment. The Bible says it's clear that Christ is coming back only for those who trust in him. And so the question is, what about little people? I know it's a parental question. I've had parents in my office. Sometimes it's why they wanted their kids to be, again, dedicated to the Lord, as if there's something salvific or salvation-driven that comes to them when they're dedicated to the Lord. It's not that case. I hope you know that by now at Bridgeway. Baby dedications are not, they're not moments that make them right with God at all. The Bible, if you read the scriptures, it talks about women who are pregnant who will be saved and caught up with Jesus Christ when he comes back. So what about a baby on board? Or what about children who are just little people that come to our Teen Kids program? That's, by the way, going to relaunch in the beginning of next fall. What about those moments? What about the kids who have not yet made a decision for Christ, the really little people? Does the Bible, again, talk about those people? Yes. So the question is, when does life come into a person's story? At conception. So at that exact moment, at conception. By the way, is it hot in here? Okay, good. All right, so in that moment when they're conceived, and that holy moment when the product of a loving couple results in a baby that's on board and it's attached to the uterine wall, and as Kara's little baby grows and other babies at Bridgeway grow, some known and some unknown, at that moment, they are worth Jesus to God, right? Because they're the imago Deis, they're stamped with the image, but they're also an inheritance of a sin nature. What happens to those babies? What happens to the little people who are coming into this world when the rapture happens, and at that moment when the Lord returns, and at that moment, do they stay behind? Do they go into the tribulation on their own just to kind of make it on their own and try to fare for themselves? I love the writings of B.B. Warfield, one of the best theologians that's ever been on the planet, and he speaks to this issue. And maybe this will help you, because I like his thinking. And again, I could be wrong, he could be wrong, but put this in your mind for a minute and think about it. He says this: all who die are raptured in infancy. All who die in infancy are children of God and enter at once into his glory. That's what he says. Not because original sin is not deserving of eternal punishment, for all born children of wrath, nor because they are less guilty than others, parenthetically, for relative innocence would warrant only relatively light punishment, not freedom from all punishment, nor because they die in infancy, again, here's the parenthetical, for they that die in infancy is not the cause but the effect of God's mercy towards them, here it is, but simply because God in infinite love has chosen them in Christ before the foundation of the world by a loving foreordination of them unto adoption as sons in Jesus Christ. I like that. So it really wraps a learning of election into that moment, saying that those kids, it's clear that when Christ comes back, he comes for those who have trusted him as Savior, and for those who have not been able to trust him, that is little people at that moment. I tend to like the way he thinks about that, and it gives me a sense of comfort, again, if we have that moment in our story with our grandbabies. The Bible goes on, who or what will happen to those left behind in the rapture? We've kind of seen a display of that. Well, really, the bottom line is judgment. When the rapture happens, in fact, let's look at what some of the theories about the rapture. I used to care about this. I'm not even sure why I have this image up here, but I will at least present it because I am a premillennial guy. But if you look at that image, here's what the main thinking is on the subject for this idea of the rapture of the church. If you look at the first one, it's called a pre-tribulation. That means it happens before the tribulation. I think there's some really compelling arguments for that. And I think the Bible teaches a strong case for the rapture happening before the trib, and then you see the orange line, that's the revelation, the second coming, the two-phased event. And then if you look, number two, the mid-trib, some people say that the church will go through the first 3.5 years of the tribulation. And they argue that we'll be taken out before the back half, which is Jacob's trouble. Some compelling arguments that are made by people who say that this is what they think the Bible teaches. And finally, the post-tribulation is that, again, that we go through the whole trib, the church that is, and that the second coming of Christ has a quick bema seat moment, and down comes Christ with the church, and then it goes right into the millennial moment. I personally like number one. I believe judgment is what God is going to pour out on this earth. That's what he's going to bring about. It's going to be a hellish time. I don't think this is, again, metaphoric. If you read the book of Revelation, man, it's a scary book. And there's things that are not real hard to understand if you take them literally. So the Holy Spirit is pulled away, the restrainer. He's taken out. More than we know, I'm going to argue more than we know, this world is an evil place, but imagine how it will be when the Holy Spirit, the restrainer, is taken out of the planet. That's what happens at the beginning of this 7-year reign of Antichrist. That the Antichrist comes in, the Holy Spirit is gone. And so if you think it's bad now, I don't think this world has seen anything yet. I think it's going to be cataclysmic. I think there's going to be all kinds of pain. In fact, it says this in Matt 24, 21, and 22, there will be great tribulation. I think I have a verse there. Yeah. For there'll be great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, nor ever shall be. Unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. So I believe that that is the reality, that judgment is coming, that judgment delayed is not judgment denied, that all the wrongs, they're going to be righted someday in this world and in the next. That's how God operates. and nobody gets away. Nobody can outmaneuver God. The second thing about the rapture, again, about what will happen, is that this Antichrist will arrive on the scene. And again, if you've read, if you've watched, if you look at movies, if you watch the Left Behind series, he's not a good guy. It's not something that we want to be around. Everything that Christ is, Antichrist is not. He's against him in every way. And everything about what he does, again, is designed to take them down. And so how will we recognize him? He'll desecrate the temple. That's pretty clear. In the spirit of Antiochus Epiphanes of the Maccabean revolt back in 168 BC, and there's all kinds of things we could say about it, he will war against God himself. And he is against Christ. That's what it means to be an antichrist. He loves to substitute himself in the place of God. And this unholy trinity of Satan and the beast and the antichrist will come together, and they will work their magic to make this world a dark, dark, terrible place. And the Bible says in 1 John 2:18 that the spirit of antichrist has already entered the world right now, even so. I think there's a spirit of antichrist that's in our world. It's the things that stand against the holy things of God. And again, we can go down the list of the cultural wars that right now we're fighting. That the definition of marriage, that's coming from the spirit of antichrist. It's that a man and a woman, it's a foolish idea, right? It's a foolish idea to suspect or to suggest that a man should marry a woman, but that's not what the Bible teaches. God's definition has lasted for 6,000 years, and that men in black and women who wear black robes have no right to trump God's holy standards. That's a spirit of antichrist, and it's in our world. That you can kill babies, and you can justify killing babies even when they come out of the uterus, and that they have had a botched abortion, and they can still take them out, and we can pretend that that's civil and normal? That's a spirit of antichrist, that dark, sinful people believe that that's a good thing to do, just like it's killing stray animals. We are such a dark, dark day. But again, 1 John 2:18 is a pretty clear reminder. John believed that the spirit of Antichrist was in his world, and someday there's going to be a capital A Antichrist, and that was something that he was teaching. And so if you just take a minute, I'll just read that verse. It's quite the statement. It says right there, children, it is the last hour. Now this is John writing. Again, around 80 or 90 AD, he says, it's the last hour right now. These are the last days. And as you have heard that Antichrist is coming, so now many Antichrists have come. Therefore, we know that it is the last hour. And he talks about how people went out from among us because they were not really of us. So what's the learning today? What's the application? The question is, are we prepared? Are we prepared for this rapid turn of events to happen? And really, two applications. How can I be ready? Is there anything the Bible teaches that I should do, or is there anything I must do? I would argue, number one, if you're a Christian, if you know Christ, if you accepted him, if you're his child and he is your Savior, you've invited him into your life. Yes, you're imperfect, but you're seeking to live for him. I'm asking you a simple question. Are you being careful in this world? That's what 1 John 3 says. Be careful, again, because someday we're going to have to give an account. We should be holy as he's holy. And we should be working as we're waiting. And we should be doing kingdom stuff like Bridgeway is continuing to do. By the way, mad respect. Kudos to the gals who went to the women's shelter yesterday and put on a breakfast and a craft. What an awesome thing. Thank you for making that happen. You're blessing their lives, you're giving yourself, and you're living beyond yourself. We had 9 that went over to the Human Life Center, and we raked, and what else did we do? We installed air conditioners and helping the cause of helping people choose babies, to not put them up for abortion. We're working as we're waiting. We believe Christ is coming, and we're concerned for his kingdom stuff. That means valuing the things the Father values as we wait for his imminent return. But if you're a person here today, and again, we should work because the night is coming. Someday, Christ is coming back, and we can't work anymore. Finally, if you're not one of his kids, it's that simple. I love the imagery of the artist that Bridgeway is a bridge, a reminder that the gospel is the only thing that bridges the chasm between God and man. That as that imagery that I remember from a kid seeing this imagery, that there's a wide and a narrow way. The wide path leads to destruction, that lower right with the arrows going off. But there's a narrow path that leads to life eternal. That is, trusting this Jesus who got on a cross in a week in the Passion story, the one who came as, again, the one who people said, Hosanna, the one who gave up his life willingly for those of us that were sinners, all of us, so that we could believe in him. Have you ever done that? Have you ever put your confidence in Jesus Christ? Again, I believe that simple principle that God's promises about tomorrow give us hope for how we face today. That maybe the reason we're here today is just simply to remind ourselves of the gospel, that the rapture is an event that will be historical, it'll be literal, it will happen, it'll take me out of this planet. Am I ready for that? And this week, we have an amazing opportunity to be about living in view of eternity, to take the gospel into the path of the people that we encounter. Will you, will I, will we be the people of God on the move to take the gospel of grace to the people that we encounter? I trust and I invite the worship team to come as we close. And I pray that, again, we will be actively involved in sharing our faith. So God, bless this word. I thank you for giving it to us from your Holy Scripture. Help us, Lord, to do something with it that changes this country and this county. May this week an active membership, an active participant in this congregation, may we go out, God, aware of your coming, and may we be contrarians to the culture, and may we detect the spirit of Antichrist in thoughts, in classrooms, and in ideas, and in wicked living that we encounter, God, that we would show the better way. We thank you that you've given us the freedom of this week. The gospel is such a freeing message. The cross of Christ and the Good Friday service that we'll celebrate at 6:30 on Friday reminds us that you've set us free from ourselves and the bondage of sin. So I pray, God, that you'll just take this learning now. May we seal it with this song, we pray, in your strong name. Amen.